Our story begins when this guy met this girl and fell madly in love. First came love, then came marriage. Then came Emily, Michael, and John in a baby carriage. They were living the dream until doubt and isolation tore love apart. One love and one home became two. In another part of the world, a loving marriage welcomed two beautiful children. Life and love for this couple went along as they hoped, and they too were living the dream. Until mom became ill. Bad became worse, and worse ended the dream. Courageously, dad strove to pick up the pieces and help his grieving children carry on. And together, they did. Until one day when this lady met this fellow. Wait, where have I heard that before? Oh well. One thing led to another, and a new dream for a new home was born. Yes, they knew there would be challenges merging homes, extended families, parenting strategies, finances, loss experiences, and holiday traditions, but they were confident that love would see them through. With hearts full of hope, they married. In the meantime, this guy, remember him? Announced that he and his girlfriend were getting married. They too had a dream for a new home. Okay, let's recap, shall we? What started out as two simple homes with four parents and five kids became three homes with three parents and five kids. And then became two homes with two parents, two step-parents, five children, five stepchildren, and the living memory of a deceased mother. And five sets of grandparents, dozens of cousins, uncles, and aunts, colliding family traditions, kids with divided loyalties, a home with five children on some days and only two the next, two bedtimes, differing parenting styles, conflict between homes, debt from the past, questions about whether this marriage will last, and four adults who quickly realize that their simple dream to recreate their dream home has instead created a multi-household family that is not simple at all, but complex. Love and hope has brought these families together, but how do they manage the complexity? And how do they make the dream reality? To find help, this home went to their local church. To their surprise, they found a ministry to blended families just like theirs. They weren't alone. With the help of Family Life Blended and their local church, this home found answers to the questions stepfamilies ask. For most, becoming a healthy stepfamily has its challenges. Becoming stepfamily smart is the first step toward helping this home and others like it live the dream. Live your dream. Family Life Blended, strengthening stepfamilies.
Well, good evening, everybody. How much did that video resonate with you? A little bit? Yeah? Well, we are so glad that you're here. My name is Jenny Boyette, and I'm on staff here at North Point, and I am thrilled that you guys are here. We, as a team, have been talking about doing an event like this for a long while, and to see this many of you come out is great because, like the video said, the church needs to partner with the step families and the blended families, right? Can I get an amen? Yes? All right. So this is our first ever step family event, and it's not going to be our last. So we are really glad that you are with us, and the reason why we're kicking it right off, I realize some of you are still coming in. I know traffic wasn't great, so grab food, find your table, but we want to get as much information in tonight as we can because we've got Ron Deal with us. How many of you are familiar with Ron and know his stuff? Absolutely. Well, if you aren't, you're going to be, and you're going to be so glad that you came tonight because he is the expert in step families. And he was up at 4:30 this morning in California and flew in and literally is hot off Atlanta traffic. And he is so excited to be here and has so much energy. I am thrilled that you're going to get to learn from him throughout the night. We have built in some time towards the end of the night that we can do some Q&A. So I know some of you are eating, but if you could write one person at the table or at least take a screenshot, we wanna show you the text in question number. So if throughout the evening there's something that Ron doesn't get to or that you feel like, I really have this question and I want to be able to ask him. We are going to have some time towards the end of the evening to go through some of your questions. We may not get to all of them, but hopefully we'll get to a lot of them. So the number is 678-585-6085. and then we'll be getting to those questions. So, all right, well, without further ado, I would love you guys to join me in welcoming our special guest, Ron Deal. Thanks. Welcome, yeah.
Well, good evening. It's good to be with everybody tonight. Sorry, could I get the screen up with my PowerPoint? Thank you. That's probably going to need to be up the entire time. Good. So we're going to be talking about becoming step family smart tonight. I bring you greetings from Little Rock, Arkansas. I work for a ministry called Family Life. Family Life is probably the largest marriage and family ministry in the world that you've never heard of. We do this thing called the Weekend to Remember Marriage Conference, and maybe you've heard of that. It comes to Atlanta a couple of times a year. About 60,000 people will go through that marriage conference this year alone in North America. Weekend to Remember Marriage Conference. We'll do it in 95 locations. We have a marriage cruise. If you really want to treat her right, guys, one of these days you need to take her on the Family Life marriage cruise. It's always around Valentine's Day. We'd love to have you go and spend a whole week. We buy the entire boat, and everybody there is there to worship God and have a good time and learn something about their relationships. We're in 104 countries, and you've never heard of us. And here's why that's relevant, because we are also the only ministry in the world that has a specific initiative for blended families. Can you believe that? There are lots of great speakers and teachers and people who have written good books. In fact, my dear friend and a co-author on a book we wrote together, Laura Petherbridge, is over in the corner. She lives in the Atlanta area now. She's a resource right here in your neck of the woods. But Family Life is trying to actually make a difference. And in the next 14 months, we are putting out more book, video, and audio resources, podcasts, the bit, you name it. Just last weekend, we did a live stream event from Minneapolis that was sent all over the country. We had thousands of people tuned into that event. If you've never heard of Blended and Blessed, we want you to get in touch with that. We're putting out more resources in the next 14 months than existed the first 15 years that I did Step Family Ministry. Because we really believe that you can have a strong family. Somebody just needs to come alongside you and give you a few answers. We want you to get smart about your step family. Now, there's a lot of people in the room. I'm assuming you're in the right place, but you know, honestly, sometimes people end up here and they really don't belong here. So I've got a little inventory that we're going to give you. You might be a step family. In the spirit of Jeff Foxworthy and David Letterman, here's my top 10 assessment list to determine whether you should be in the room tonight. You might be a step family. My job is to read the top 10 list. Your job is to say the refrain. Could you say it with me? You might be a step family. 1, 2, 3. You might. Number 10 way to know you might be a step family. If you had your rehearsal dinner at Chuck E. Cheese, you might be a step. Come on, folks, say it with me. You might be. Number 9, if your honeymoon was at Legoland. Number 8, if you got his and her car seats as a wedding gift. Number 7, if you have Thanksgiving dinner at 4 different homes, you might be a step family. Number 6, if your family tree looks like a shotgun blast, you might be a step family. Number 5, if the age span of your children is 2 decades or greater, you might be a step family. Number 4, if your new marriage comes with built-in grandkids, you might be a step family. Number 3, if you post your marital status online as often, you might be a step family. Number 2, if you can't remember all of your kids' last names. And the number 1 way to know that you might be a step family is if you have ever been slapped in the face.
Hi.
Hello.
Aw, thank you. Have a seat. Kyle, Jalen. Jalen, Kyle.
Jalen, you play nice.
I'll be right back.
What's going on, little man? I see you got your game skills down pat. You might have your hands full once. I'll pick up the controller, little man.
Put it back. Keep your hands on my mama. Keep your hands on my Doritos.
Jalen, are you playing nice?
Keep your hands off my mama. Keep your hands off my Doritos. This was a Super Bowl ad. Doritos, about 5 years ago, went viral. Of course it did, right? What's that all about? Keep your hands off my mama. Keep your hands off my Doritos. This poor guy just comes over. He's going to take this woman out. They're going to have a good time. He's going to sweep her off her feet, right? He thinks it's simple. all of a sudden, a slap in the face tells him that it's complex. All of a sudden, he now realizes that the rules are different in this scenario. For whatever reason, the rules are different. What do you mean the rules are different, Ron? What are you talking about? Well, you know, the relationship rules, like how things work. You see, in a biological family, there's an old phrase, maybe you've heard of it. The best thing a father can do for his children is to love their mother. Let me say that again, because it's really good and it captures this notion of how all the relationships are intertwined and connected in a family unit. The best thing a father can do for his children is to love their mother. That makes sense, right? If he's loving mom, then it creates this wonderful environment where their marriage is the foundation of the home. And the kids then grow up in a climate where there's love and there's stability and continuity and the parents are in charge. And sometimes kids don't like that, but at the end of the day, it's really good for them. And their world is better because mom and dad love each other, right? I mean, what happens to kids when mom and dad aren't loving each other? Well, they get anxious and worried and they want you back together again. It's what they do. So the best thing a father can do for his children is to love their mother. Now, the other side of that little triangle is also true. When dad spends time with one of their children, does mom get jealous? No. In fact, that warms her heart. You know, the mama part of her heart gets warm, and the mama part's connected to the wife heart, and that usually results in some good feelings all the way around. And the same thing's true. If mom spends time with one of the kids, dad's pleased by that. The best thing a father can do for his children is to love their mother. Well, apparently the rules are a little different from the video we just saw, because here comes a guy. Is it equally true to say the best thing a stepfather, or future stepfather in this case, is the best thing a stepfather can do for his stepchildren is to love their mother? Apparently not. Keep your hands off my mama. Keep your hands off my Doritos. You see, what he's saying, this young man is saying is, look, this is my territory. I live here. This is my mom, not your girl. She's mine. And if you take her and love her, that's taking her away from me. You see, in a biological family, all relationships flow in one fluid fashion. They all move in the same direction. The best thing a father can do for his children, the best thing a mother can do for her children, what husbands and wives do for each other, cares for the children. In biological families, that's true. But in blended families, in the beginning, they divert. They go in different directions. What the adults want is often different than what the children want, and moving at a different pace and in a different direction. And sometimes they just flat out collide, because you and I are now competing for this woman's heart. My mom, your girlfriend, same woman, but we're competing. That means you and I are at odds. Now, that's true on day one, but what we know is over time, those paths eventually merge. It's the merging process that where there's a lot of emotional work and relational work, and it takes some time. And how do we get there? How do we make that happen? How do we do that? Well, that's what I mean by getting smart about your family. When you manage the merging process, when you don't freak out because of that. See, but if you're over here going, but wait, it's supposed to be easy. I'm going to sweep her off her feet. All relationships move in one fluid direction. And then all of a sudden, the slap in the face says to you, that's not true. And all of a sudden, you figure out there are different rules here, but what are the rules, and how do I deal with this? And shouldn't they be the same? Well, why aren't they the same as over there? What's wrong with us? All of a sudden, you have lots of questions about this process. And what's really fascinating is that the more you understand that process, the more you make sense of it, you have a perspective, it's not intimidating anymore. If you begin to work with it rather than inadvertently against it, and the merging process gets better. But without that, sometimes you end up with stress. Here's my little equation I want you to remember today. Complexity equals stress. The complexity of the rules being different, the complexity of you and I are in competition for this woman's heart, the complexity of this is my territory. Think about that when this young man says, keep your hands off my mama. What he's saying is, I'm an insider with my mom and we belong here. You, my friend, are an outsider and you do not belong. That is the task of a step-parent. It's to move from being an outsider to being an insider. And the insiders have to like open the door and let you in or you can't get in. Any of you step-parents in the room figure that one out yet? In any relationship, the person who is the least motivated towards the building of that relationship has the most power and influence in that relationship. Let me say that again. The person who is the least motivated towards the relationship has the most power over the relationship. And this young man at the age of 5 or 6 has a whole lot of power because he's an insider that the potential step-parent does not have because he's an outsider. All they have to do is say, talk to the hand, right, step-parents? And you get slapped in the face. See, all those complex dynamics create stress. And here in a blended family, what that does is it tends to erode the relationships. Okay, look up here for just a second. It's kind of a simple little illustration, but here's him and here's her. And the reason you guys created a family to begin with is because you found one another. Right? Your marriage is the first motivator to the rest of the people in your world figuring out how to merge. The marriage starts it all. So the marriage, you come together, you start dating, you fall in love, you decide to get married. On the day you get married and walk down the aisle, you have declared to the world, we are a couple, till death do us part. Done. Settled. We now know who we are. We have an identity as a married couple. But what you maybe didn't fully appreciate is how you've posed the question to all of these people. You've also asked them, why don't you be family with us? And by the way, who are these people? They could be children. They could be former spouses. They could be former mother-in-laws. They could be your debt. They could be the emotional wounds on your heart. You bring all of that with you, no matter what the story is, and you're now asking those people and things and dynamics to merge. Only some of the people don't want to. Some of them are like, nah, I don't need that. I'm still holding out for something else. And we have this motivation clash. Complexity equals stress. Like, what do you mean you don't want to? Well, what do you do about your kid? Why won't your kid let me into their heart? I don't understand. I'm doing everything right. I've read all the books. It's not working. What do I do? I'm not sure. I wish I could tell you, honey. I don't know how to solve that one. It's complex, and that creates stress. And stress over time in a blended family, instead of moving you towards merging, creates this dynamic where it thickens blood, and people tend to pull away and go back where it's safe to the people and the things that they know the most. And at the end of the day, that pulls on your marriage. There's a reason the divorce rate is higher in blended families than it is in first marriages, because of this complexity and the stress. And you just get slapped in the face and like, what do we do? And how do we navigate these different rules so that we can make the merger go in the right direction? So what we want to do tonight, right off the bat, is I want to ask this question. How in the world do you cook a step family? Let's just have a little fun with that conversation for a minute. How do you cook a step family? Because we're going to try to merge these ingredients. We're going to try to put them together. Now, we do call them blended families every once in a while, so you might assume that you use a blender. That would be incorrect. Why? Well, for one reason, blenders have blades. Somebody's getting cut up, all right? You know, that's a little dangerous on everybody who's involved in that little scenario there. Blenders have blades, and they use friction and rapid, throwing things together. And now, if you're making smoothies, this is a wonderful way to cook a blended family, or cook a family, is to throw it in a blender. But in step family situations, it tends to work in the opposite direction. The classic blender move is a very well-intentioned parent or step-parent who goes to the children and says something like, if it's a step-parent, it would sound like this: hey, I know I'm not your mom, but I think you're pretty cool, and I'm kind of hoping you think I'm pretty cool, and why don't you call me mom anyway? Now, that's a classic blender move. We just break that down, and we go, okay, what is going on here? She is just wants to build a relationship. She's an outsider. She wants to be an insider. She wants the kids to feel safe and comfortable with her. She wants to be family. That's why she got married. This is the whole point. So, of course, she wants to push the kids in that direction and let them know that it's okay with her, that you can call me mom, and that makes a whole lot of sense to her. But inadvertently, when it rolls through the children's ears, through the different lenses and perspectives and experiences and the rules being different, what they heard is, oh, you just chopped up my biological mother and you're trying to replace her. Not gonna happen. Keep your hands off my mama. Keep your hands off my Doritos. Like when you try to push your way in and force the blend, it tends to push back in the opposite direction and does the opposite effect. Blenders are not a good idea. Had one stepdad say, or biological dad and a stepdad. So he had kids, his wife had kids. His wife's kids were with him 24/7. As soon as he married her, he's with her kids all the time. His kids come every other weekend, right? And they were teenagers, and so as life happens, things would get in the way, and so that was somewhat inconsistent those first couple of years that he was married. And so he really was desperate for time with his kids, and when they came over, he wanted it to be good time with his kids, right? So he tried to orchestrate all the togetherness and happiness moments. All right, kids, come on out. We're going to play games tonight. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. And his kids kind of did this formal thing where they would come over and hug dad. Man, glad to see you. And then they'd go over and shake. He said they would shake my wife's hand. And then they'd kind of say hi to their step siblings. And then they would retreat back to their bedrooms where they would just stay for long periods of time. And he was like, they're never going to merge if they don't come out, right? So then he would go to his kids and he kind of get angry. Right? By the way, anybody in here with teenagers ever find that being angry with them helps them to be happy? Come on, guys, I need you to want this. You see, that's what the blender mentality essentially is it's the dance of want. I need you to want this. I want you to want this more than you want this. So now I'm going to orchestrate, cajole, I'm going to get angry from time to time. I'm really going to tell you all the benefits if you'll just get on board. And we do all this stuff to try to make the merger happen today. And it's so well intended, but what you got to hear is that that's violating. The only person who can decide whether they want to have a relationship with a step person, whoever that might be, is that person. And you can create in a climate and an environment where it's more likely to happen, but you cannot force the blend. And the more you try, the less you'll accomplish. The more stress you'll have, the more difficulties you'll have, the more it pulls in the opposite direction. So how do you cook a step family? Look on the screen. You do it with a crock pot. You don't use a blender at all, you use a crock pot. Why? Because crock pots work on a totally different system than anything else. Now, I did not say Instapot. I said crock pot, slow cooker, whatever you call them in this neck of the woods. A crock pot works on time and low heat, a whole lot of time. How much time? 10 minutes? An hour? No, like all day, like you go to work. Put it in the morning, go to work, come home, you got food. 6, 7, 8 hours, depending on what you're making, right? It needs time, and there's low heat in this crock pot. You do have to have some heat. I want you to be intentional in your family to bring some heat to the equation, because if you don't, there's not going to be any cooking. So you got to create climate and expectation, and there's little things you can do, subtle things that you can do that help with that, and then you magnify over it a lot of time. Patricia Papernow, who knows more about the merging process than any researcher in the country, says that it takes the average step family 5 to 7 years to find their family identity, their familyness. Now, some of you just went, oh, dear God, what have we done? Oh, my, are you kidding me? 5 years? We're in year 2. Hello, this is stressful. I know. You get those slaps in the face because the rules are different. Like, it's just not as quick as you thought. And by the way, there's complexity even to that whole merger process. Like, what if you, okay, so let's just make some stew tonight. Let's make blended family stew, all right? What do you guys throw in your stew here in Atlanta? Shout it out. Ingredients? Carrots. Potatoes. Beef. What else? Onions. Good. Some spice. Who? Garlic. All right, we got some good stuff. Great. Throwing it all in the crock pot, you don't even have to stir it, you don't have to mix it, you don't have to do anything. You just throw it in there, you put a lid on it, turn it on, and you walk away. This is called a wedding. And things begin to cook. And if you come back in 30 minutes and you start eating, doesn't taste good, somebody's getting sick, the meat's not done, right? You're going to the hospital. You know, you got to give it a little more time than that and things. And what happens in this crock pot? All the ingredients begin to warm up, and then they soften, and then they share of themselves. They merge. That's how it works. Warm up, soften, and then they share of themselves. And it just kind of happens. But you got to have a little bit of heat. So one of the two heat tools I want to give you tonight, one of them is compartmentalization. And the other one is what we call growing your middle ground. Middle ground is what you have on day one. Even when you're dating, you begin to figure out middle ground. This is what you have in common with ingredient one or ingredient two, with the carrot, with the potato, with the beef, with the garlic, whatever it might be. Middle ground is we both like sports. We both like fashion. We both like this. We love going to our church together. We love worshiping God together. That's kind of a thing we can connect around. Middle ground is where it all starts, step people. You want to take advantage of your middle ground and be very intentional, because that's the natural heat. You start with that. But let's add to it this compartmentalization idea. Compartmentalization is when you go on a date, you're compartmentalizing as a couple. You leave the kids at home, you go on a date, that's couple time. You could do the same thing in step families, and we really recommend it. It's a little paradoxical, like it feels like the wrong thing to do, but it's the right thing to do, so stay with me. When a biological mom spends time with her child or children, and stepdad and step-siblings are not necessarily connected to that, that is a wise compartmentalization. They're spending 20 minutes laying on the bed at night, talking to the ceiling about the day. Why? Because that's what mom did with her kids all those single-parent years. That's how they survived life through some difficulty times together. And they need to know that mom is still there in that way for them. It's a little ritual, but it carries a whole lot of meaning and connectedness. And when they spend that time together without stepdad, oh, but if he's not there, we won't merge. Yes, you will. Just relax. What you're doing is you're moving toward your kids in a strategic way so you can move toward your husband in other ways. You move towards them so they know that you're still there, that they haven't lost all of you. They have lost some of you. You can't argue with that. They've lost some of your time. They've lost some of your attention. You're now giving a big part of you to some other person and some other person's kids, if in some cases. And so it has changed. And so they just need to be reassured of that. But then you can compartmentalize and have couple time. And when that balance is brought into the picture, especially in the early days, that helps give you an opportunity for the stepchildren to look at the step-parent and not as somebody who is taking mom away from me. Keep your hands off my mama. Keep your hands off my... But as somebody who shares her, as somebody who I can respect, as somebody who gets us, who cares about me. Now, we're going to talk about the marriage component here in a little bit, but do you see how that ministers to the heart of a child, especially in the early days? By the way, let me just push pause. For those of you that have adult children and you're sitting here going, does this apply to us with our 35-year-old? Yes. Everything I'm saying applies to adult kids just like it does minor age children. We'll do some of the transitions of that in a minute. But they just need to be reassured that they haven't lost all of you. So when you put these two things together over time, again, magnify time, it adds up to a warmth that keeps the ingredients warming up, and then they begin to soften. Now, here's the catch. Mr. Potato Head also spends time in another pot. And he spends every other weekend with you. But carrot and celery and spices are with you all the time. They have more opportunity to warm up. And if they're younger in age, they warm up more quickly than do teenagers. And if they are 25 and in college and graduate school and starting their career and they just have other things on their mind and they're just not around very much, that slows down that ingredient's cooking time. Everybody else is kind of coming together, but Mr. Potato Head just kind of isn't. It doesn't mean you've failed. That's very, very important. Part of the challenge is enjoying what you do have while you continue to just try to be intentional about what is not yet. So many people walk around and just go, we're a failure because we haven't done this yet. Well, that's unrealistic. What's realistic is that each ingredient will cook in its own time. I had a chef, his wife actually came up to me at the end of a conference one time, and she said, my husband, he's a chef, and he says, you're right about that crock pot thing. You can't fool food. And I said, what does that mean? I have no idea what you just said. She said, oh, well, what he says is you can't make something cook faster than it will cook. Right. You got it. You can yell at that carrot for not being nice to the step-parent. Probably doesn't help them warm up. You could go and put pressure on them and you could say, look, we're going to blend whether you want to or not. Probably isn't going to help them warm up and soften. Like, they have to figure that out themselves. You create climate. They have to figure out how to work with it. We're going to go to our first table talk. Look on the screen. We're going to give you a few minutes. Here's what I want you to do at your table. Maybe you've already done the first part with a sketch about your life. Just take a quick 10 seconds to go, hey, we're dating 5 years, we've got 12 kids between us. Or, hey, we're married. We've been married for 3 months or 10 years or whatever it is, and this is how many kids that we have between us. Just real quick, go around, share a quick sketch. Then I want you to stop and ask yourself, oh, what kind of blendering things have I been doing? As Ron was just talking there about the blender stuff, I kind of recognize that I do that orchestrating, pushing sort of thing. And if you're willing to own up to that in your little group time, I'd love for you to just say it out loud, all right? And then the last part is, what would it look like if you were crock-potting a little bit more often instead of blendering? What would you do different? And try to be specific. Like, I would just do this one thing a little differently, all right? We'll give you a few minutes to get to know each other. Talk through those questions real quick. Ready, set, go. All right. So I'm really curious. I just want to, you've gotten to know each other a little bit. Just real quickly, I'm curious. Who drove more than an hour to be here? More than an hour, raise your hands. More than 2 hours, keep them up. More than 2 hours? Anybody? Where? Where'd they go? Everybody's less than an hour. Wow, that's amazing. All right, good. So you're right here in this neck of the woods. What? How long did it take you guys to get here? An hour and 32 minutes to be exact. All right, whether you're dating or married, raise your hand if you've got three or more kids between you, and if they're adults, go ahead and count them because you're paying for something, I guarantee it. Three or more, keep them up. Four or more, keep them up. Five or more, keep them up. Six, getting to know our audience here. Seven, who's still up? Where are the hands? Did we lose everybody on that one? So six, you guys put your hands up again. We got a bunch of sixes, look at that. Yeah, okay, great. If you're wondering, I've had three couples over the years with 12. And I had one couple with 17. Just put the gun, yes. 17, he had seven, she had seven. They adopted three international kids after they got married. That couple flew our first summit on Step Family Ministry. We do this ministry equipping thing for lay leaders or pastors or whoever wants to come to that. They came to our very first one, flew from Montana, where they live on a ranch because they need it. Went all the way to Dallas, participated in the event, got motivated, went back to Montana, called me a few months later, brought me up to do an event, launched a Step Family Ministry in their church all by themselves. If they can do it, you ain't got no excuse, all right? All right, now let's talk a little bit about protecting your marriage, specifically within this merging process. Let's talk about protecting your marriage. Watch this video. What you're gonna notice is that this couple starts off with a parenting dilemma, but it quickly becomes a marriage dilemma.
We basically met at work, just like a lot of couples do. And I realized that, you know, because going into the marriage, for me, it was just, hey, this is great. She's got some kids and I can handle that.
Well, when we first got married, my children were teenagers, ranging from 14 years old to 18, 19 years old. And as far as having my children accept him, it was kind of difficult for him to take on that role.
I remember the first day walking in like a sergeant. And I remember the kids watching TV like 8 hours a day. You know, I'm like, this is it. I turned the TV off, said no more TV during the day. Talk about, you know, backfire. You know, it literally, because they weren't used to discipline in a household like that.
And I was more of a easygoing type mom and kind of gave into my kids more than I should have.
I tell you that our marriage was challenged. I mean, there were times that it was bumpy. I didn't think we were gonna make it. I felt handicap. I felt like my hands were tied. I said to my wife a long time ago, the reason why we're gonna get divorced will be because of the kids and because you're taking their side.
Because I was a single parent, I guess I was, you know, emotionally very tied to my children. I wasn't able to put my husband first.
I felt like, hey, here I am, these aren't my kids, and I'm coming into this relationship trying to make a difference, trying to make a positive impact. And I just felt like that wasn't being appreciated. You know, not having the kids would have probably saved about 80% of the arguments. We got through it, but I will tell you, it was not easy. It was a challenge, and it was a challenge every single day.
At the intersection of Parenting Street and Marriage Avenue is a really tricky intersection. It's pretty easy to have some crashes at that intersection. It starts off with a parenting issue. How much TV do we let the kids watch? Quickly, that becomes a marital issue because now we don't agree about the kids. And to mom, it kind of feels like, hey, you're infringing on my territory a little bit. We need to talk this through. I don't like the way you're going about that. But he's going, look, the boundaries are a little low. We need to work on it. Real fast, it becomes a marriage issue. Now, let me show you in this little process on the screen. I want you to write down some things in your notes. Let's watch this process, because what I'm going to show you is what a typical blended family goes through and what explains what we just saw in that video, all right? In a first marriage relationship, you have an individual who marries another individual and they become a couple, all right? This is not rocket science. This is how the whole thing starts. Individual, another individual, couple, and then they have children. Children flow out of coupleness. Now, let me just pause for a second and make a couple of observations about that. The reason that's God's design for life and the home is that it establishes the couple as the foundation, and then you build walls and put a ceiling on and do the parenting and raising of the children, and that's all related to the couple being first. They're the foundation. Another thing that you'll notice about that is that parenting flows out of the marriage, right? It sets you up. And you can say to your kids, look, your mom and I were here before you showed up, and we're going to be here long after you're gone, so get over yourself. The household does not revolve around you. That's a developmental process that children need to learn, and that is that the world does not revolve around us. It really revolves around mom and dad. And if we don't get that right, we raise kids who think they're entitled to everything. And one other observation I have about that little process is that the kids are just as invested in that scenario in their parents' marriage as the parents are. Like, they want mom and dad together and happy. And if you're struggling, they want you happy. And if you're separated, they want you back together. And if you're divorced, they probably still want you back together. Now, sometimes kids know that's not the best thing and there's good reason. Whatever that story is, they're smart enough and savvy enough to understand that from time to time. But at the same time, thank you very much, they want you together. Like, that's the dream. Okay, let's look at the next level. Because what happens then after death or divorce or a dissolved relationship is that you have that individual. And now we've lost the foundation. Coupleness has been removed and the parent-child relationship remains. And what naturally occurs is that the home has to regroup. Like, we lost the foundation, how now are we gonna do life? Well, that single parent in that home naturally is going to kind of revolve everything around their relationship with the children. That's not necessarily a bad thing. Kids kind of learn extra responsibilities, and sometimes they learn how to be more assertive and take care of their younger siblings and learn a few life skills. That's a good thing. But if it's burdensome, if they get parentified, you know, there's extremes where it's not necessarily good. But I want you to just notice that we've lost the foundation. That's a huge adjustment. It's a big trauma to that family, that household. Okay, now let's look at this next slide. People get creative in their single parent years. You'll notice they kind of go and recruit. Now, I just want to point something out here. This open position, they're looking for a dad because there's a mom and then the other kiddos. She's hoping some guy's going to come and fill that. Now, here's the natural thing, and I want you to see this. What's mistaken about that ad riding around on the back of her car, is that she's not giving her kids a father. She will give them a stepfather. And they are two very different things. In the kid's heart and mind, a father would be restoring what has been lost. You are not restoring what has been lost. You are not repairing. You are creating an entirely different home. Let me show you what I mean. You see, what happens on after the blended family marriage arrives is that we have the individual, we have that parent-child thing. It is long, it is established. We have new routines. We have a new way of doing things around the home. In the video we just saw, we have mom and her standards about TV watching, for example. And now we are adding on coupleness and with that, a step-parent role. You are an outsider step-parents on the day that you walk in or get dropped into the crock pot, if I could say it that way. You're an outsider trying to become an insider, trying to find the routine, trying to find the harmony. But notice, coupleness parenting does not flow out of coupleness. Parenting flows out of parenting, out of the single parent's momentum and relationship and definition with the children. Coupleness doesn't provide the foundation for anything. It's an add-on. Keep your hands off my mama. Keep your hands off my Doritos. But look up here, because this, if you really want to protect your marriage, what you have to be able to do is you have to move coupleness back into a place of priority. You have to move it to a place where you lead from a position of oneness again, so that at Parenting Street and Marriage Avenue, there's not collisions that take you apart. Now, I want to be really clear about something. This does not come at the expense of children. What I am not saying or suggesting that when you get married to somebody, you abandon your children. Please do not hear me say that. It's not saying that at all. As a matter of fact, the parallel that I would give you out of Scripture in Genesis 2 and 3 is that it's not good for man to be alone, and then lo and behold, he's not alone. And then what happens? God says a man leaves his father and mother, he cleaves to his wife, and they become one flesh. There's a shift in his allegiance that all of us are called to when we get married. We leave father and mother. Does that mean abandon them? Does that mean never talk to them? Does that mean be disrespectful to them? Absolutely not. As a matter of fact, we have a commandment about honoring your father and your mother. So nobody is saying that that relationship goes away. We're saying it changes. You leave in the sense of your loyalty is not there primarily anymore. It's secondarily there. Your primary loyalty is now to this spouse to whom you cleave. Commitment, dedication, till death do us part. The same thing has to happen in a blended family marriage. You have to, in effect, leave your children. Now, I just put some angst in somebody's soul because you know what is good and right, and that is that you are all they have. And you're not going to stop doing that. You're going to raise them and love them and invest in them and spend all those years driving to softball games and whatever, just like you were going to before. But there has to be the shift in alignment, or you haven't really cleaved to your new spouse, and you can't position your marriage back to where you lead the family. It was at this point in a seminar years ago where a guy raised his hand and he told me a story that I'll never forget. Right in the middle, he goes, "Hey, I don't like this." And I go, "Okay, tell me, what do you not like?" He goes, no. "I like this. I don't like that, and that's my life." I said, "Please explain." He said, "I was never married before. I don't have any biological children of my own. When I married my wife," he said, "let me tell you, as a single mom, she didn't lower the standard at all. She was large and in charge. She's an awesome mother. Her kids respect her. She follows through on everything. She's sophisticated and complex, and she's got it going on. Let me tell you," he said, "she even had this elaborate system with her kids of determining who rides in the front seat of the car when they would get and they would go places, right? And it depended, she had three kids, and so it depends on where they were going, whose turn it was, who was going to be back in the car another turn before somebody else gets back into the car." He said they had this algorithm figured out. And I was smart enough not to mess with that. So when we got married, I got in the back seat and we just went on with life. And then he says, "We've been married 2.5 years, and I still ride in the back seat. And I don't like riding in the back seat." How do we move him to the front seat? Let's have a little fun with this. Let's play it out. It's Monday morning. They have one family car, you know, big old minivan or something, you know, and they all hop in and drop off at school and work and go on their different ways. And you can just see that stepdad out there marching, "But I'm not sitting in the back seat. I'm sick and tired of sitting in the back. I'm not going to sit in the back seat." And out comes little Johnny. He's 10 years old. "Shotgun, my turn. All right." He runs around the side of the car. He opens up the door. Stepdad goes, "Nope, dude, not today. You're riding in the back. I'm riding in the front." What's Johnny going to do? "Oh, thank you, stepfather. I'm so happy to accommodate you, more than pleased to be moved to the back seat. Not a problem. I don't think so. This is where I like to talk about the gas that kids give us. G-A-S-S, it's an acrostic. These are the tools children use against us: guilt trips, anger, silent treatment, and sadness. You got it? Write it down, because they're going to use it. Guilt trips, anger, silent treatment, sadness. I don't know what Johnny's going to do, but he's probably going to be one of those four. He's going to do the sadness. You can't do that. It's my turn. And some kids are straight to anger. You can't. You're not my dad. You can't tell me. Some kids are going to do the guilt thing. Oh, my word. I cannot believe all I have been through in my life that you... And in that moment, stepdad, they're going like, nope, look, I'm not giving in. You're right in the back. And about that moment, mom walks out the front door of the house. Johnny spins around. My savior. Mom, you can't believe. And he's going to give gas to her. Your husband. And she's going to go, what's going on? And mom, in her mom sense, it knows instantly what's going on because she's seen this before. And her husband's done something. She don't know what it is, but she's kind of mad at him. And she's kind of mad at her son. And if they could just be happy, like we could be one big merged, blended family. But no, you guys can't be happy with one another. And here we go again. And she looks at her husband, and she looks at her son, and she looks at her husband, and she looks at her son. And what if she looks at her husband in that moment and says, because she's trying to figure out the Solomon cut the baby in half thing to make everybody happy in this moment in time. By the way, pause. Let me just say this to all adults in the room, especially you bio parents. You cannot make everybody happy all the time. In the merger process of different directions and different motivations and strategies, and potato head who doesn't want to even be in the pot or is only here every once in a while and he has a different motivation when he does come. In the midst of all of that complexity, you cannot make everybody happy all the time. Please give yourself the gift of tolerance for disharmony. The trick is to lead through the disharmony. You're still going to lead in the midst of transition and change and some disharmony so that you create in that climate of warmth where ingredients warm up and eventually soften on their own time and begin to share of themselves, but that's up to them. So back to the mom's dilemma now. What am I going to do? I don't know how to solve this. Looks at her husband, looks at her son. What if she looks at her husband and says, honey, it is his turn. Wouldn't you mind sitting in the back one more time? Men in the room, what is this stepdad feeling at this moment in time? Shout it out. Disrespected. What else? Insignificant. Do what? Insignificant. Marginalized. Emasculated. Oh, you had to go there, dude. Yes, that's what he's feeling. All of those things. And I got to applaud this audience, because usually when I ask that question, men go, I don't know what he feels, but I know what I'm going to do. But we just had four feeling words coming out right there. Way to go, guys. That is awesome. Yes, that's what he's feeling. But back to the mom's dilemma. What if she looks at her husband, looks at her son, looks at her husband, looks at her son, and says, son, you got to get in the back. What's Johnny going to do? Oh, thank you, mother. I'm so happy. I'll be happy to accommodate you. I don't think so. Some of you have one child that will do that, but the others, what's happening with the gas? If the gas was like a 3 on a 10 scale, it just went to a 9 because my mom left me. And that's why it's so hard to say, get in the back. Because you know that might be how they feel. Now, is it true? Did you leave him? No, it's not true. Just in that moment, he just experienced, and here's where we need to jump in the child's shoes for a second. In that moment, he just experienced another loss. Another change moment I didn't ask for. Another transition in the series of transit. Another little piece of hay on that haystack. Here we go again. It's this, and then it's that, and then it's this, and then it's that, and then we lost this, then we had to move into that house, then we had, now I got a stepbrother taking my stuff, and now my stepdad's taking my seat. I'm sick of it. We should not be surprised that they have gas. There's some hurt in there. It varies in its size and its feel, but it's another moment I didn't ask for. I didn't want Dad to die. I didn't want this divorce thing happening. I didn't want this remarriage thing happening. I wanted the mom, you to get married to this guy because he's a great guy, but then I don't want him telling me what to do. I want him to be my stepdad in the sense of he provides for me and he's fun and we play football and we enjoy that, but I don't want him telling me to get in the back seat. That's a different story. So don't be surprised by gas. But how do you lead within that? What I wouldn't want mom to do is I want her to get in his shoes for a second. I want her to put on some huge compassion, and then I want her to follow through with the behavioral limit or whatever the situation is called for here and be the mom. So in this moment, she might look at her son, and she might just do the compassion thing. Oh, man. It is your turn. Here we go again, changing the rules on you. Man, if I were you, I love that little phrase. If I were you, I'd be kind of mad at me right now because this is hard. Like, you were looking forward to this. This is always the way we've done it. Of course you expected this in the front seat. I totally get it. This is really difficult. That's the compassion. Now get in the back seat. There's something magic about that little combination. If you do it over and over and over and over and over, it actually creates a little warmth in the crock pot, oddly enough. If you don't, the alternative is to cave and to give in to his sadness, to his gas, whatever that is. Will that extinguish gas? Nope, because it's just trained it that it works, right? So its gas is going up over time. It's not going away. And by the way, that's ironic, because if your kids are hurting a little bit about what's happened in the past and they're a little sad about that, you inadvertently keep them in their sadness when you get paralyzed and you don't do the parenting thing. When you cater into the gas, you keep them paralyzed in their sadness. That's not helping either. He needs to figure it out. Life changes. You got to sit in the back seat. But I love you. I'm crazy in love with you. I get it. This is so hard. Give me a big hug. Now get in the back. Now what is Johnny going to do at that point? Is he going to be all happy? Probably not. He's probably getting in the back, slamming the door, giving her the evil eye of the way to school. Going to make it suffer. And then he's getting out and he's slamming the door and then he's stomping off. He's not saying goodbye. And mom's heart's going, what did I do? What did I do? Did I do the wrong thing? No, compartmentalize. At the end of that day, go pick him up. Do a little TLC. Get an ice cream cone. And then the next day go, now get in the back. Show him that he hasn't lost you, that you're still there, that you get it. You have some compassion for this. Now get in the back. That process over and over and over positions stepdad not in the back seat, but in the front seat. Now we as a couple can work through this thing together. By the way, if we could rewind that whole scenario, let me just say this to step parents. I would say to that stepdad, don't you dare blindside your wife by making a unilateral decision and making a declaration on your own. Don't you dare do that. That's a setup. Have 10 hours of conversation with her behind closed doors about how she's going to move you into the front seat. And then as a couple, make the declaration, and mom can push it out to the children. Why? Because she's the mom. She has a clearly defined relationship with the kids, and everybody knows it, and they will accept her authority if she will just follow through with it. It's the stepdad who really can't make those changes, not on day one in the crock pot, because he's the new guy, and like, who are you? Who gave you that authority? We need mom to follow through with that. But they got to be a unified couple, so he puts her in the front seat, so she can put him in the front seat, and then they can lead from the front seat. And you have 2 weeks of hell while there's gas spewing everywhere, and then it gets better. And you begin to crock pot and cook. Look up on the screen, little table time, table talk. Here's a true scenario. I want you to talk about it at your table. True story. Here's a biological dad and husband saying to his wife, the stepmom, don't come between me and my children. They can't get another father, but you can always get another husband. Yeah, whoa, right? Let me read that one more time. Don't come between me and my children. They can't get another father, but you can always get another husband. At your table, I'd like for you to just real quickly talk through those four questions. What are his priorities? What impact do you think this is going to have on his wife and her wife heart? Okay. The next question is, how's it going to impact her relationship with the children, the stepmom heart, the mom part of her? What effect is it going to have on her role as a parent? And then the last question is about him. What do you think is going on with him? What are the fears that are embedded inside that? We're going to give you about 10 minutes. Ready, set, go. Okay. By the way, if you guys like the social media thing, up on the screen is how you can follow if you're interested in any of that, Facebook or Twitter. We have a new podcast we just launched this month, Family Life Blended. So just take a picture of that screen if you're interested in any of that. My guess is you came up with some pretty good things in your list. Oh, by the way, I'm forgetting. I pulled some cards out. So if I read your name, come up and get a free resource. Mark, is it McKay? Mark McKay, Stephanie Williamson, and Christina Flower. Come on up. We got some resources up here for you guys. Anybody moving? Yeah, there you go. Come on up. You can fight over them. This is for kids, Life in a Blender, if anybody's interested in that one. And yeah, that's a devotional book, and there you go. So it looks like you get the last one, dude. Thanks, guys. Thank you. Yep. Yeah, my guess is you came up with some really good things, like that first question that's asking about what's the impact of his priorities. What does that statement say about his priorities? It says his kids are his priorities, right? And the second question was, how is this going to affect her wife's heart? You can imagine her back at, if we were looking at that other screen, like she's the add-on, right? She's in the back seat, however you want to say that. She's probably feeling like she's being drugged behind the car. Like she's not even in the car. Like, I don't even belong. Like, I'm disposable to you. I feel insignificant to you. I feel insecure because of this. I feel not valued. And we all know, boy, she's going to want to have sex with her husband that night because feeling insignificant and not valued, and that'll turn on a woman's sexual energy. And then the third question is, like, so how does that affect her role as a step-parent in the family? And I imagine you said something about it's going to undercut it. Like, she knows she's walking on eggshells about everything with the kids. If she does something wrong, is he going to turn on her? How's that going to go? So that's going to disempower her in being able to function as a stepmom. And, I mean, do you suppose the kids would pick up on that at all? I mean, but they wouldn't abuse it or anything, would they? There's at least one child that will, right? And you know who that is in your family. That kid will absolutely abuse. And then the last question, though, is about him. So what fears are embedded in that statement? And if you got underneath it, maybe you said something at your table like, he's afraid of losing his kids. I don't know what the backstory is. Maybe he's got a former wife who takes him to court a lot. And if she catches wind that there's any sort of stress going on with the stepmom in this household, she's going to be right back in his face. They're going to be right back in court with bills and all, facing all that conflict. Maybe he's had one kid who just is kind of pulling away, and he just is worried about that child, and he's afraid that he'll just go live with mom or grandma or something. Maybe he's afraid of trusting his wife and letting her into the parenting picture. Like, maybe there's something about her style he didn't care for. Maybe he's just worried about the family. I want this thing to blend. Maybe it's a blender move. I want us to merge. And so it just gets messed up when you step in and start doing something. So just back off. Don't come between me and my kids. Let me make this thing happen. I'm not sure what his rationalization was. He probably has some honest and genuine and, what's the word I'm looking for? Fears that are valid, but that still didn't make it the right thing to do. He inadvertently disempowers his wife from any parenting role. He marginalizes her from the marital role. He throws her in the trunk and then says, come on, let's merge. It's not going to happen. He's got to find the courage to put her in the front seat. See, at Parenting Street and Marriage Avenue, there's an intersection. And all these things come together in that particular moment in time. Speaking of parenting, Let's talk a little bit more about that. State Farm has a commercial for you.
At last.
Sometimes at last doesn't happen at first.
My love has come along. My lonely days.
Your dad just kissed my mom.
Are over.
Turning two worlds into one takes love.
And life is like a song.
Helping protect that world takes State Farm.
Who knew? All you need is State Farm. No, so what she says is, your dad just kissed my mom. Like, something's changing in our life. Something's radically different here. Now, what does that mean for me? What's the implication? It doesn't necessarily mean all bad things, but it does mean change. And this is a kid who's had a lot of change already, so it's more change on top of that, and we've got to figure that out. Now, your dad just kissed my mom, so what does that mean your dad is to me? Let's talk a little bit specifically about that step-parent role. Look up on the screen. If you would, just leave the slides up for a minute here. These are a couple of resources that we have. The Smart Stepmom, I co-wrote with Laura, sitting over there. The Smart Stepdad is written specifically for stepdads, all about that role and what it is to get inside that role, if that's something that you're interested in. Now, watch this. The attachment difference. I want to talk about what's different about being a bio parent from being a step parent. Bio parents have what's on the left. You're an insider with your kids. You always have been. You always will be. And what that means is, when it comes time to be a parent, they give you grace and conflict. If you blow it and you apologize to your biological kids, they tend to, like, let you off the hook. It's okay, Dad, you know, I understand, I love you, I forgive you. And there's this warmth and there's this, you know, forgiveness that kind of flows easy. And that's a two-way street. We do that for our kids. You have insider status as a parent with them. You have automatic love, automatic approval, automatic trust, access to their world, and they feel emotionally safe with you. Why? Because you're my parent, period, end of story. Now, a step-parent on day one doesn't have any of that. You got to earn all of it. The kids are easily angered. Like, kids will be tolerant of a biological parent who has just a quirk, you know, like maybe you got a temper or you just do these weird things and everybody just, you know, it's kind of like they give you grace for that. But if you're the step parent, you don't get grace for that. And they're trying to decide how they're going to love you and how much they're going to approve of you and how much they're going to trust you. That's a whole journey and a process. Gary Chapman and I are writing a book right now, merging his love languages information with my blended family information, okay? And what I'm really excited about is because we're diving deep into this whole thing about trust and approval and love and how the process of love developing between parents, step-parents, and step-children is different and how you use the love languages differently. But what I want you to just kind of capture here real quickly is that bio parents have a whole lot of stuff that allows, that elevates your status in the heart of the child that step-parents have to earn over time. And the crock pot will get you there, but on day one, it's not there. Well-intentioned biological mom, let's say, who says, honey, you're the dad of my kids now, just do what dads do, has not understood he can't do what you do. He can't be to them who you can be to them until he's earned it. It's a setup. You got to work together. You got to help elevate his status. Let me tell you what I mean. Now, based on what we just saw there, if you're dealing with a 16-year-old who has an attitude, if you would, let's leave the screen up for a minute. If you're dealing with a 16-year-old with an attitude and you're the biological parent, what do you see? Well, you see a 16-year-old with an attitude, but you also see this. You see your precious little child that has been in your life forever, and all of the memories are yours. And sometimes they have a face anybody could love. And sometimes they have a face only a parent could love. And by the way, if you're the biological parent and you don't like the face, it's okay, you can change it. Feel free to have a little fun with that. After all, they're yours, all right? Now, what does the step-parent see when they look at that same 16-year-old with an attitude? They don't have the same emotional attachment, the depth, the history, all of that kind of stuff. Well, they see trouble. It's just not not the same, right? I mean, you could just be in the same moment in the same room and feel it differently in that moment with a kid. Now, parenting is difficult. We all know that. If kids are blessings, we love our three kids, but man, if they came with parental controls, it would be easier. But of course they don't, so they'll be bad boys from time to time. And sometimes they'll be really bad boys. Oh, come on, that's funny. I don't know how we're gonna get that one off. It's touch and go. So yeah, they'll be bad boys and they'll get into trouble and you'll wanna hang them out to dry, but somehow we gotta remember that they're children and we take them into our hands, that they're a gift from God. It's just easier when they're yours. Which is one reason some step-parents tell me they feel like they've been thrown to the lions. That's hilarious. By the way, it gets better every time you see it, so let's watch it again. Here we go. If you're a lion, this is called delivery. Application. Stepkids can stop you dead in your tracks. I think that's what we're saying. It's just a different process for step parents. So let me share with you this model that we created to help you understand the difference between biological parenting and step parenting. This is a really elaborate chart and it should be in your handout so you don't have to create this thing. Let me see if I can just focus your attention in a couple of directions just for a minute. Look up on the screen if you would. So degree of authority to discipline. So really what we're saying is up and down this axis has to do with how much status do you have in the heart and mind and soul of the child. Do they perceive you as being a parent? And how much authority do you have in that? Now you'll notice biological parents on day one in the crock pot, you have lots of parental authority and you always will. That doesn't change. Why? Because you're my mom, period, end of story. Because you're my dad, period, end of story. You might be a jerk, but you're still my dad. I love you, end of story. That's what attachment gives you. But step parents on day one start out down here like this. You're like a coach on the soccer field on day one in the crock pot. You're like a teacher on the first day of school. My wife's a teacher, teaches kindergartners, loves the little ones, special gift. Any of you that teach little ones that is a gift, you'd be nuts to have 20 kids, 5 years of age running around you, unless you knew what to do with them. She knows what to do with them. Now they fall in love with Mrs. Deal pretty fast, let me tell you, and that's true for children in blended family situations too, foster kids, adopted kids. Under the age of five, they tend to attach themselves to that person and you gain a lot of status real fast in that relationship. But kids between the ages of 10 and 15 have the smallest window of attachment and it takes them a whole lot longer to move up the scale and see you as somebody who's a parental authority. But you're always at least a teacher. Now, here's the thing. Now, if you just pause for a minute, what I want you to see is that the bio parent has the authority and can get stuff done that the step parent can't. Bio parents, you've got to set step parents up for success. You're the big dog in the house. And part of your job is moving that step parent into the front seat, extending your authority to them. Hey, kids, while I'm gone, she's in charge. We do this with babysitters, right? Don't you give your kids the speech when your babysitter comes over? And how's it go at your house? It's something like, all right, she's 14, she's cute, we don't even know who she is, but she's in charge. I'll do everything she says. And you walk out. And for some reason that works because you've lended power to her. Bio parents, that's your job, is keep elevating the status of the step parent because they're gaining who they are, their identity, their attachment. They're building that in the crock pot slowly over time. They're not just born with it. So back to our model, you can see that if bio parents are doing their job, step parents can eventually work their way out of being babysitter to more like your extended family member, uncle, aunt, something like that, all the way up to being somebody with a high degree of relationship authority. But what happens, do you think, if a step parent comes in and gets that out of order? They come in and they start trying to be this person. Years ago, I was working for a church, and I got a phone call one day, and it went like this. Hi, we're marriage mentors at our church, and we have a problem, and we want to talk to you about this situation. And oh, by the way, I have to tell you, I've been thrilled to tell this story tonight because the mentors were from North Point Community Church. I've told this story for years, and now I get to tell it here, all right? It's kind of fun. So the mentors call me and they say, here's the deal. We just talked with this couple. We're mentoring them. They're going to get married in about a month. And she just had a phone call with her fiance and it really concerned her. And so she didn't know what to do. So she called us and we didn't know what to do. So we're calling you. Would you help us coach her on what to do? And I said, hey, I'll do my best. Sounds like a setup to me, but hey, I'll give it a go. Tell me what's the scenario. She goes, all right. So she just got off the phone and here's the backdrop. She's divorced. She's got three kids. They're in that, they're like 11, 13, and 15. And I just said that 11, 10 to 15 is one of the hardest age ranges just for kids in terms of welcoming new people, step-parents, step-siblings. It just is what it is. And they're all three of them were in that range. She's marrying a guy. A, he's never been married before. B, doesn't have any children of his own, so he doesn't really know anything about parenting hands-on. And C, we should tell you, he's an ex-Marine. Now, anybody in the room who knows Marine knows there's no such thing as an ex-Marine. Hoo-ah, right? He's an ex-Marine, and he was just talking to her on the phone, and he told her, he said, honey, you need to tell your kids that when you and I get married next month, tell them the Marines have landed. Mother. She didn't know what to feel about that, so she hung up with him. She called it. They didn't know what to tell her, so they called me. So here's what I said. Tell her, good luck with all that. Because, no, I didn't really say it. I said, all right, let me explain to you this model. Like, if we could help them to not do that. Like, if he'll understand that there are some limits to his role, that he can be an authority and working in relationship with his wife, and she can set him up, then he can move into that place. But if he comes in large and in charge, blowing and going, jump, you say how high, and has that sort of expectation when he hasn't earned that right in that relationship with the kids, it's probably going to backfire. I spent an hour and a half with him on the phone, and I made one crucial mistake. I never asked the names of the mentors or got a follow-up phone number at that point in time. It was way before email and all that kind of stuff. And so they hung up, and as soon as they hung up, I went, oh, I don't even know who you are. I'd love to know how this thing goes. So do these people call me back? Like, you know, I bet Ron really is really wondering how this went. Do they think of Ron at that point in time? Do they just go on with life and let me suffer in silence? That's what they do, all right? I never found out what happened. I'm walking around. I wonder what happened to that Marine guy. Man, I wonder what happened. A year and a half goes by, and I go to Nashville once every 2 years. There's this large Christian counselors conference, and I'm doing a workshop on stepfamily therapy, and there's 350 therapists in the room. And I told that much of the story because it's a good story to just say, look, that's kind of going it backwards. Don't let your clients do this. Da, da, da. The workshop's over. We go back to one of the exhibits, and this lady, some people are standing around talking, asking questions. And this one lady goes, can I talk to you? So I go over there and I say, can I help you? Yes, I was just in your workshop. It was great. Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. I just wanted to let you know, you told that story about the Marine man. That was us. And I was like, wow, you're the mentor. Like, I totally didn't ever get any information from you. I didn't know how to get a hold of you. I really want to know what happened. And she goes, no. You don't understand. That was us. It was my fiance who called me, and I called the mentors, and they called you. Oh. So I said, so what happened? And I'll tell you what she said in just a few minutes. Okay, so... See, you don't like waiting either. I had to wait a year and a half. I'm going to wait. Make you wait just a couple of minutes here. Okay, so we got some fine print down here at the bottom of this. Some of you are going, he's really going to make us wait. Yes, I'm going to make you wait. Length of time required to increase parental authority will vary according to. These are some of the things that we know from research make a difference. But then you have all of those just Mr. Potato Head factors that are in there. But the age of the child is number one on that list. And I already told you, kids under the age of 5 generally welcome a step-parent much more rapidly than do kids that are a little bit older. By the way, if you have adult children, they're not trying to put you into a parental status. If they're adults when you get married, they probably don't even think of you as a step-parent. It's dad's wife. And isn't that pretty far removed? What you are trying to do is build a relationship, a friendship with them. You're still trying to become a little bit of an insider connected. You're still an outsider. You got to figure out a way to move into their heart. It's just not necessarily, would you please pick up your socks? Right? So it's still a relationship development process that's affected by age. Previous family experiences. Kids who have had two stepdads before you walked in and bio dad is a loser, guess what? You got 3 strikes against you before you ever walk in. Like, you have to overwhelm that negative experience in their life with kindness. And just expect that cooking in that crock pot to go more slowly. It is what it is. The next factor down there says non-custodial parents. What if you have a biological mom, you're the stepmom, and the biological mom's in the other home saying, she's not your mother. As a matter of fact, I will really be mad at you kids if you like her. And every once in a while you have a parent who actually says that out loud, but most of the time we don't say it, we just imply it. You didn't really have fun this weekend, did you? Oh no, she can't help you pick out that dress. I need to help you pick that out. No. It's those derogatory, condescending, negative things that send the message to your kids that puts a burden on their heart. Would you please, if this is you, would you please stop? Please stop. Puts a burden on their heart where they now have to take care of you by being a pain to their stepmom and keeping her out of their heart. They have to go to work over at dad's house to care for mama. No, that's not the way it works, gang. That's the other way around. We take care of them. We don't ask them to take care of us. By the way, if you're the stepmom in that scenario, what's your power? Because she's putting venom and poison on them about you. Well, my guess is she feels threatened. Maybe it's just some time, a little bit of time. Maybe you have a bigger house and nicer hair. I don't know, but there's some threat there. It's about her kids. Mama bear stuff, that's real, okay? And so threat, if threat is the issue, one of the things you can do is give her the no threat message. Laura and I talk about this in our book. The no threat message is something to the effect of, and you can email it or you can text it or you could say it face to face if you feel like that's the appropriate way to deliver it. That's up to you. But the message is, hey, look, I want you to know that I know that you're the mom and I'm not. And I will never try to come between you and your kids. I am never going to replace you. Your mom, I'm not. I will speak well of you behind your back. If anything, the kids come over and we forgot to send the math book, you call me and I'm going to make it right. We're going to try to work on this. I just am honored to be able to contribute a little bit to the raising of your kids. Thank you for your time. Have a nice day. You're communicating that I'm not a threat to you because she needs to know that. She needs to know that you know that. And maybe, just maybe, if that takes root in her heart over time, she might just find that you're tolerable and that she doesn't have to poison so much. And all of that pressure comes down and the children get to be kids. But that's one of those factors that goes on between home. What about temperament and personality? Some kids are more outgoing. They just love people. They're extroverts. Some kids are introverts and they just don't need another friend. And stepmom, you're not it. Sorry, I got all the friends I need. That's one. I'm done. You know, some kids, that's just the way they are. And then there's that last one that says parenting style variations. Like, one of you parents this way and one of you parents this way. It's kind of like our video we saw. Mom says, yeah, you can watch 10 hours of TV a day. Stepdad's like, no, I don't think that's going to happen. Like, the standard's different. And what do you do when you guys find those little circumstances like that? That's a challenging situation. Because, like, does somebody come down? Does somebody go up? Do you meet in the middle? And here's the answer. I don't know. What I do know is that you have to put each other in the front seat. And if you put each other in the front seat and make those decisions together, then whatever the answer is probably is going to be a pretty good answer. Now, there's good parenting practices, and you can study those, and you ought to have a good sense of what motivates children. That's important for you to be aware of. But if one of you works on this philosophy and one of you works on that philosophy, neither philosophy will work. My wife and I get to go to Ghana every year and work with some formerly trafficked children, and we love it. It's the joy of our life. And one of the men there, one time I asked him, I was trying to pick his brain about family life in Ghana, and I said, so what did you learn about parenting? He said, you know, my daddy taught me that two voices do not raise a child. One voice raises a child. Two voices do not raise a child. That is so profound. One voice. One voice, one voice raises a child. That's part of your unity in parenting, and it's also, since Parenting Street intersects with marriage, it's also about your marriage. It's always about both. And so when you work at those parenting decisions and put each other in the front seat through the process, you find out your marriage gets stronger as a result. But wasn't that the situation with Marine Man? Well, see, I didn't forget. I owe you the second part of the story. Some of you forgot already about it. So I go to this lady and I say, so what happened? She said, well, he came in like a Marine. And I was like, oh. So what happened? Then he started barking orders and expecting the kids. And I so wanted to support him as his wife, but I couldn't support how he was going about it. Sidebar, you see, your harshness doesn't help. And the way you present yourself really matters in this. You may have the best of intentions in the world, especially you step-parents, but remember, you don't get grace early in the crock pot. Like, you have to earn the right to have grace from the kids. And so the bio parent can be harsh and get away with it. It's a different standard. But for you, you can't do that. But he did. And so she was like, I wanted to support it, but I couldn't. So then I found myself trying to represent to him the kids and what their thoughts and feelings were. But then he would accuse me of taking their side, and you could see where they ended up pretty fast, right? They're polarized. They're polarized in how they parent, and it's pushing their marriage in the wrong direction. And I said, oh, I'm sorry. So what happened? She said, I went on for about a year like that, and then one day he came to me and he apologized. I was like, oh, that's good. She said, and then he went and apologized to my kids. I was like, that's even better. And I said, I know that didn't fix it right away. She said, no, there was quite a bit of water under the bridge at that point. And so it's been about 6 months and they're just trying to heal. And I said, okay. And then she made this really good observation. She said, when he apologized, he came to me and he said, you know, all that stuff they were trying to teach us. And I realized that I really had the best of intentions, but I started us off on the wrong foot, and I'm sorry about that. She said, then he said, I needed to downshift. So he went back down to being the stepdad. And she said, when he did that, I realized something. I had been countering him all this time. And so as he was going up, I was going down. I want you to hear this, because this is a pretty common pattern. Like, the more he did this and she went down to try to balance the family out, I call it the teeter-totter effect. Then when she went down, he'd go back up a little bit more, because somebody's got to be the parent in this house. And then she would get a little bit soft on the rules. And then he would go, well, I've got to take. And then what happens? They are polarized in parenting and in their marriage. She said he realized he needed to downshift, go back to healing and trying to build a relationship and start over with the kids. She said, when he did that, I realized I hadn't been mom for I don't know how long. And I needed to pick up my game and start being mom again. And I was like, that is so good. She said, it's been about 6 months, and that's what we're doing. I said, well, thank you. I really appreciate you telling me what happened. 2 years later, I went back to that same World Conference of Christian Counselors, and I told that much of the story. I think it's a pretty good story. It makes a good point. And I told that part of the story. And guess what happened? 300 people in the audience, and when the workshop was over, 5 people walked up to me and said, we know who you're talking about. And I'm like, I don't even know who I'm talking about. I don't know their names. I don't know I don't know anything about them. They go, yeah, well, we're in a counseling practice with her. We know exactly who you're talking about. And I said, so what happened? And I said, well, they're doing pretty good, as a matter of fact. Things are going, clicking along, moving in the right direction. It's like, all right, I'm glad to hear that. 2 years later, I went back to that same World Conference. I told that much of the story, and three people walked up to me when the workshop was over and said, we know who you're talking about. I don't even know who I'm talking about. They said, yeah. Well, I said, so what happened? They said, well, they've kind of hit a little speed bump, and things are kind of hard a little bit right now, and so we're praying for them. I'm like, oh, all right, I will too. I don't even know their names, but I'm going to keep praying for them. 2 years later, I went back to the same World Conference. I'm not making this up. I told that much of the story, and nobody came up to me after the workshop. So a year and a half ago, I went back one more time, and I told that much of the story, and I begged somebody to come up and tell me what happened with this couple. And you know what happened? Nobody came up. So I don't know what happened. And neither do you. But I'm here, if there's anybody in the room. Come find me when the workshop's over so we can talk about and you can tell me what happened. I don't know what happened with that one, but I do know what happened with this one, and I'll close with this and then we'll go to our question and answer time. Does anybody, last Saturday we had this event called Blended and Blessed. It was a live stream event. You could be anywhere. Put your hand up if you happen to tap into that. Okay, no, I don't see any hands in here. I told a story about Mike and Holly. 18 years ago, I went to Houston, Texas, and did a step family all-day conference event for a church. And in the audience was this woman named Holly. Just so happened we kind of struck up a little side conversation and got to know each other a little bit, and I got familiar with her story. She and Mike were about to get married about 3 months later. Mike couldn't make it that day to the conference, so she was there taking copious notes to try to share with him. She was marrying a guy who had three teenage daughters, 11, 13, 15, right in that age range, right in that tough age range. And by the way, stepmoms and stepdaughters is one of the most difficult combinations just naturally because of a lot of things I won't go into, but it just is what it is. Stepdads and stepsons is a little bit easier by and large on all things being equal. So here's this woman who doesn't have any children of her own, never been married before, marrying a guy, three teenage stepdaughters. She's taking copious notes. 3 months later, they get married, I guess, right? The event was over. They go on with life. 7 years later, I go back to Houston. I'm speaking at a different church. Guess who shows up? Mike and Holly. This time, Mike's with her. So I pull them aside, and I said, so what happened? What's going on with you guys? And they tell me this story about how the first 3 or 4 years they went into the blender and it was hard, like, and there were clashes and personalities and Holly and the kids, but she was trying to pace with the children. She was so trying to grow into a relationship with them, and Mike was trying to be the parent and, you know, kind of maintain all those standards and buy time for all the women to figure out how to get along with one another. And she said, you know, we had 4 or 5 years of really, really hard stuff, but then we started turning a corner around year 5, and we just celebrated our 7th wedding anniversary, and the girls came to us and they said, well, you know, it's not just your wedding anniversary, it's our family anniversary. And we'd like to celebrate with you on that night. So they got kind of a cake, and it was kind of like their wedding cake, and they just, you know, had the top of it remade. And they sat around and told stories and laughed and shared memories of their family. Like, clearly there was an investment at that point in time, and things were going really pretty well. Now, if you read the Smart Stepmom book, you will read that much of the story. It's in the book. What you won't read is what happened not too long ago when I went back to Houston, a totally different church. Guess who shows up? Mike and Holly. And this time they're leading a ministry. They're bringing couples from their church to that event so that they can be blessed. They're pouring into other people because they're 17 years down the road. And I pull her aside and I say, so what happened? How you guys doing? She says, I got to tell you, the crock pot just keeps doing what it does. I said, yeah. She said, not long ago, my oldest stepdaughter, the one that I had all the difficulties with back in the day, she and I were at some social event, and there's a lot of stuff going on around us, had nothing to do with our family, and all of a sudden she stopped me right in the middle of that social event, pulled me aside and said, look, I need to ask you something. You have been in my life a really, really long time, and you're kind of like my mom. Do you mind if I were to call you mom? And what do you think she said? No, I don't want you to call me. You see, being called mom or dad is not the goal. Only 30% of kids will ever use that term for their step-parent. That is not your goal. The goal is relationship. When relationship is formed and built, sometimes you get those labels that reflect the relationship. But relationship is the goal, not the label. But she ended up getting the level after 17 freaking long years. You know what I'm talking about? She got the label. She had this moment where their relationship went to a new place. You see, the crock pot doesn't ever quit. Some of you are here tonight and you're really unhappy about what's going on in your home. Or maybe you got four or five ingredients that are moving and grooving and you got Potato Head. It's just not cooperating. It's not happening. And by the way, Potato Head can be a former spouse. Enough said, you know. We don't have time to go into that one tonight. It could be a former mother-in-law. You get the point. Like, there's just people and things and dynamics you don't get to change and get to control. And there's stuff you're happy with and the stuff that you wish were different. Don't quit following God and walking and moving and doing the right things and making the right choices and putting each other in the front seat, because in that climate, the cooking keeps going. And who knows what's going to happen? So many people never really have a great relationship with their stepchild, but when that stepchild becomes an adult and gets married and has a kid of their own, all of a sudden you become not step-grandparent, although technically that's true, you become grandma. And now that stepchild sees you through the eyes of their child, and that can transform your relationship with both generations. There's all kinds of things if you just keep cooking. If you hop out of the pot, you got nothing. Let's take some time for some Q&A. I'll let whoever come up with the questions. I want to just hit a couple of resources on the screen before we jump into that and tell you about a couple of things. Blended and Blessed is this live stream event that we do every year. Would love for you guys to get tapped into that. You can actually, the whole thing is videotaped, and if you'll just go to blendedandblessed.com, you can find out how you can get a hold of that and use it as a small group tool or just do it individually as a couple. We train ministry leaders. I would love for this to not be the last thing North Point does for blended families. Have you enjoyed your table time and your conversation at all? Has that been fruitful or helpful? Right? When you get to talk to somebody who kind of gets your life, like, it's really great. And that's what we believe happens in small groups and Sunday school, whatever that format looks for you guys. Let me encourage you to go the next step. This event tries to help train people to be able to do that. The Summit on Step Family Ministry. This is my new podcast. We'd love for you to get tapped. The one this week is all about parent alienation. Some of you are in the room, and that is your demon. And that's what we're talking about this week, as a matter of fact. And then this is just a bundle of resources that are available. My new book on finances comes out this fall, and the one with Gary Chapman will come out next February.
Awesome. Thank you, Ron. Yeah. So good. Well, we have a couple questions, and we don't have a ton of time, but I want to go through that. And as I'm doing that, I just wanted to let you guys know that we have a member of our church that wrote this book, Bonus Mom and Bonus Dad, and there's one for every couple or person, if you're with your spouse, just for free on your way out. They wanted to share this with everyone. So it's mainly Very for cool. younger kids, but it's a resource. They're a step family, Great. And so we have that. And then we also have a bunch of Ron's books and everything out there. So if you want to pick one up before you head out, you can do that. So helpful. Couple of questions that we've gotten, and you guys can keep sending them in, but we may not get to all of them. And the first one is, my wife's ex continually sends her snarky text messages. Up until this point, I haven't commented or said anything to him, but I'm reaching my limit. At what point do I say something to him, if at all?
Okay, so always step one is put each other in the front seat. So don't do something unilaterally. Make sure your wife is in touch and in tune, because you don't want to self-sabotage inadvertently, right? So you go to her, express and articulate your concern, talk through this as a couple. My guess is you already have, and she's still saying no, don't. And there may be good reason for the don't. It could be that that will ripple into the kids and make their lives really difficult and strained, or, you know, whatever the reasoning is there. I will say this. I do think there's a time and a place to be direct. But I want you to be gentle, assertive. Put on the fruit of the Spirit, gentleness, in your assertiveness. You can do those at the same time. Hey, look, dude, I know you would never really put your kids in any, and use the kids, because that's his motivation. His motivation is not making you happy. His motivation may not be anything related to your wife, his former wife, making her happy, but his kids might be a little bit of leverage. Look, I know you'd never really intentionally try to hurt the kids, but every time you say something snarky to their mom, it creates a mood between the two of you that ripples into their lives. Like, they feel it, they feel the stress and the strain. I see it in their eyes and in their heart. And I just think you're hurting them. See what happens, right? Any step beyond that is another conversation between husband and wife to decide whether you move forward and do something different.
All right, this one, it's heavy, but it feels really important. I thought I could handle step-parenting before marriage. Now that I'm married, I don't like it. How can I change my attitude and save my marriage?
Yeah, whatever the backstory is, maybe there were, you know, expectations that haven't been met, and I think that's a universal experience. There's something about it you didn't see coming. It is what it is. By the way, that's true of life, right? Not everything is stepness. Like, any parent in the room knows you didn't see that coming. If you've had teenagers, you didn't see that coming. And so, swallow hard, and you need some support. I would really encourage you to find some people you can talk to about that. I hope maybe some of the things we've talked about tonight will help bring you and your husband or wife together so that they are a little more compassionate for you and how hard it is for you. Like, I really want, you know, what I said earlier about attachment, biological parents, your kids can be decent and kind and give you grace in ways that they will never do with, but aren't right now with the step parent. And so when you say to your spouse, look, what's wrong with you? They're fine. Their experience of your kids is very different than yours. And your spouse needs your compassion. This is why bio parents need to give step parents a big hug every now and then. And it's that, honey, you get the short end of the stick, and I love you for it, hug. Thank you for all you do for my kids with what little you get back. I just want you to know I'm with you, and I'm sorry, and I'm working on it. We're trying. If you're a team in that way, then the step parent can maybe sustain throughout the difficulty and keep pressing forward.
That's good. One of the things, if you guys have been around North Point at all or one of our other campuses, we talk about community a lot. And that's one of the reasons it's so important for us to be in tables and the table discussion that we had. And so being in community is so important.
Stepmoms who get together and talk and commiserate and, you know, kind of spew a little bit so you can go back in and not spew.
My counselor says set the buzzer for 20 minutes, vent, and then
it'll be
kick
done
it
with
back
it.
In gear.
Yeah. There's something about, but make sure you're not just venting. You're studying things that are moving you towards the heart of God. You're trying to figure out how to be love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control in the midst of rejection.
Yeah.
Like, if that's your scenario, that's hard. But that's what it is to be Jesus in that. And it doesn't mean you have to be a doormat. Doesn't mean that at all. You can say to kids, I'm sorry, you may not talk to me that way. I know I'm not your mom, but your dad and I have talked, and these are your chores, and you need to get with it. Mm-hmm. Again, notice, your dad and I have talked. Like, there is unity. It's not just my voice, it's his voice. So that helps the step-parent be parental, because you've borrowed power from, it's kind of like the babysitter thing.
Yeah. Okay. And just so you guys know, you'll be getting an email. It's probably coming in your inbox right now. So if you are wanting to connect with other step families and form a group, I realize we're just about to be in the summertime, but we want to provide a place that you can have connection and be in community. Right. So you'll have that, and there'll be a place for you to sign up. We have several groups that are going to be meeting over the summer, and some are short term, some are longer term, but know that's in your inbox and you can get more information there. So we have a couple more questions here. What advice do you have when the step parent is suspicious of a step child's intention, but as the biological parent, you don't think the child is being manipulative? The child is just being honest and is either really sad or honest.
Yeah. Insiders. As the insider biological parent, you have a lot of perspective and history and knowledge that is unparalleled because they're your kids and you've been with them forever. At the same time, be humble enough to know that you can be duped. And that an outsider can sometimes see things insiders can't see because they just have a point of view. The first thing biological parents need to protect against when it comes to these parental negotiations is defensiveness. Like, hey, you're talking about my kid, and you're also telling me that because she doesn't get up in the morning that I've been a bad parent. So it's a cut on my kid, and it's a cut on me. And so defensiveness is a thing you need to guard against, bio parents. It doesn't mean the step parent is right about their observation, but just try to be open to it. Try to get past defensiveness and try to be objective so that you can talk around it. If the two of you can't solve it, find somebody else. Dialogue with somebody else who makes observations about your kid. Talk to grandma, she'll tell you.
They do, don't they? All right, we have several couples or people that are considering becoming step families that must be in a dating relationship. So we have several questions that are on the same lines, but it's basically asking, when is the best time in the relationship to begin integrating the kids? When do you begin this process? And then do you inform the kids ahead of time this is happening? So anything you can talk to those that are in the beginning stages, and you have a room full of people that are in process that I'm sure have feedback and suggestions.
But up on the screen, let me just show you the title. Bottom right of the image, Dating and the Single Parent. That's the book for you guys, okay? It's all about the dating process, how you include kids in the process, how you look at your relationship one-on-one, the dyadic relationship, but then your considerations of the whole family unit. I think it is just as viable. It's a deal breaker if you start dating somebody and find out that they're a huge addict, all right, and not interested in quitting. That's a deal breaker. It is also a deal breaker to consider to be dating somebody and find out that they have the ex-wife from hell and that you're marrying her by marrying him. I think that is a serious consideration that you need to look at honestly. I'm not saying you should break up. I'm saying don't be dumb. And that book helps you analyze and think through red lights, green lights, and yellow flashing lights and how you respond. One of the things that we say about helping kids is have what-if dialogues with your children continuously, bioparent to children. Hey, what if I started dating again? Even before you go there. What if I were to start dating? How would you feel about that? What are we doing? We are not asking their permission. You're, A, informing them this might happen. And number two, you're looking for feedback. You are not trying to convince them that what you want is right for them. Don't do that. That's blundering. But when you listen to them go, oh, Dad, that'd be totally weird. I don't know how I feel about that. You need to know that because that's going to affect how they respond when the time comes. You can begin dialogue and communicate and revisit that. And, oh, by the way, I want to let you know I'm going to go out this coming weekend. How are you feeling about that? Let's talk about that. So it gives you a way to check in. And then you, what if I were to keep dating her? What if we were to get engaged? What if we were to get married? You're constantly checking and moving. Think of it this way. You're moving toward your kids so you can move toward this other adult. You don't just do one or the other. You do both strategically. The research is very clear. Kids who have a sense that they were able to contribute to some of the process of my parent getting married again, on the back end of that wedding are more likely to embrace the step-parent compared to kids who didn't see it coming, were told, hey, we're engaged, where did this come from? Hey, we eloped, meet your new mom. That kind of craziness just invites them to be against it. So the more you move toward them and give them a voice, not permission, not, but a voice, the more they feel like they're a part of the journey.
Well, and when you say, I'm sure there's someone in here like, oh my gosh, we did elope, or oh my gosh, we didn't bring our kids in the mix. And so it's never too late, right? Wouldn't you say you can address that depending on the age of the
kid
and just go back and apologize and say, we want to bring.
I've done this 1,000 times as a dad. Mm-hmm. Kids, I made a mistake.
Yeah.
I didn't know. I thought I was doing. I was wrong.
Yeah.
Own it. Say that. Apologize. Here's what we've learned. Here's what we thought. Here's what we've learned. And I now realize that created some difficulties for you, and I'm sorry about that. Can we talk about that?
Right.
Maybe they talk, maybe they don't talk. Maybe they're still angry and hurt, and it's going to take a while, but you've started the process of healing.
Awesome. Well, we are out of time for questions. You guys started sending them in now. But Ron, you're going to be with us down here up front. We don't want, I know it's been a long day for you, but those of you that didn't get your question answered or want to have some more discussion, please feel free to stop by and shake Ron's hand and meet him. But before we have a couple other prizes, and on your table, like I told you guys before, this is our first step family event. And this is something that we want to continue to do. We want to partner as the church. And so you have a QR code that is on your table. This is like high tech, not so much for me, but those of you that know how to do this, you like scan your phone over it and it pops up a survey. And if you want to do that here, you can take it home with you. But we really want to know what went well, what didn't, what can we do better, what other events do you want? And so please communicate with us and give us that feedback. So while you're looking at that, I'm going to draw two more names out and we're going to give some prizes. How about that?
Great.
Is this all right if I grab? We have this prize is going to be for a date night. How about that? Just you and your spouse can go on a date night here. So where is, oh, of course, I pull one that I'm the worst. Vinod Massey, this is terrible. They are you kidding? Should they have to be present to win? Like they stepped out like they're at the bathroom? They said you were in charge. So then you should win. You think, I don't know, what do you think? Should, you're like,
Smooth, very smooth.
You're like, that was smooth. All right, I'm gonna draw again. Sorry, I just made an executive decision. Candace Smith, right here. All right, Candace, you guys have a date night. Now, the next basket is for a family date night, right? So all the kids and everybody can go. Cindy Rogers. Cindy here? Yes, maybe? All right, yay. Okay, you have a date night. So, oh, absolutely, yes. Okay, so we know how that can be for having to take a whole big family up. So that will be good. All right, well, I know you want to pray for us, and then we'll dismiss, but thank you guys so much for being here, and don't forget to give us your feedback, and we'll see you in the halls.
Speaking of dating, one last story. So this man and this woman were dating, engaged, ready to get married, love of your life sort of thing, and then she comes to him, and she says, I'm pregnant, and he knows two things. You've betrayed me, because that's not mine, because we haven't had sex. And he's like, I'm done. And he walks. And then the Spirit of God taps him on the shoulder and says, hey, Joseph, we have an assignment for you. And Jesus gets a stepdad. We have two stories about Joseph in the Bible, two, and they both clearly point to the fact that he's not the dad. The first one is the one I just told you, not my kid, I'm out. No responsibility, no obligation, and yet he chooses love. He chooses the obligation, he chooses the responsibility, and any step parent in this room, you are a hero in my book for doing the same. The other story about Joseph is when Jesus is 12 and they go to the temple, and we all know that one, right? Jesus gets lost and they're crazy for 3 days trying to find him, and then they find him and they go, and you can imagine the speech and waving their finger and what that was all about. Where have you been? What have you been doing? And Jesus looks Joseph in the eye and he goes, I was at my dad's house. Now, Jesus did not say that snide and rude as if to say, you're not my dad, you can't tell me what to say. But it is a reminder, you're not my dad. Jesus goes on, the Bible tells us he responded with respect and grew in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man. So he had a wonderful, loving posture towards Joseph. But clearly Joseph is reminded that he's not the dad. And isn't it a miracle of all miracles that the God of heaven who chose to come down here and love us and Joseph was chosen by Joseph to be loved by him? It's an amazing thing when we pull this off. And aren't we all glad for who Joseph was in the life of Jesus? We don't really know. We don't have that documented, like what role he played, but he was picked for a reason. You have journeys in front of you. You are in a crock pot. You're trying to figure out the daily walk and what that looks like and how to come together and walk with one another. Just remember, you're not alone. You're in really good company. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you so much for embracing us in spite of who we are, in spite of our sin and our frailties and the way we disappoint you. You love us. I thank you, God, and praise you tonight that family structure has never been what determined whether people were worthy to you, whether they were lovable to you, whether you would use them for your kingdom work and agenda. It has never been a disqualifier. None of the people in this room are disqualified. I don't know what their journey is or what their story is. Some of them have sin involved with it. Some of them don't. But whatever it is, it doesn't disqualify them from being your children. We praise you for that. We thank you for that. And from this day forward, would you empower them as they walk together, as they love, as they make decisions, as they parent? Would you give them strength for the journey? Would you support them and remind them that you are with them always? In the power of Jesus and in the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. God bless. We'll see you.
Thank you, Ron, very much. Thank you guys again. Ron will be up front, and we will see you guys in the halls. And if this is your first time at North Point, we're just glad that you are here, and we would love for you to come back and see us sometime. Thanks. Have a great night.